Irene Fenton.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for welcome over. At last. Support my colleague Phil Twyford's SOP, which will refer local board power allocation to the Local Government Commission to determine a set of minimum activities for local boards. And I wondered if I could if I could go through some parts in the legislation that cause us particular concern around the issue of local boards, starting in Part 1, Clause 17, which, as the part says, that the initial allocation of powers for the board will be made by the ATA. Now, other colleagues have said that these powers are going to be allocated by an unelected body. That's of significant concern for us. The non-regulatory activities of the Auckland Council will be decided between the local boards and the governing body. Here it is in black and white, Mr. Chair, our first concern about local boards. In Part 2, Clause 35, membership of local boards. The clause sets out the statutory minimum of local board members at 5 and a maximum of 12. Now, our concerns around this, Mr. Chair, is that the majority select committee reports have noted that the maximum membership for a community board is 12. But it goes on to state that local boards will have more responsibilities than community boards and will serve a larger population as the rationale for lifting the membership of local boards. They then set the maximum at the same level as the community board. It doesn't make any sense, Mr. Chair. If local boards are really going to have more responsibility than community boards, wouldn't it make more sense to ensure they have more representation than community boards? Another area of concern in the legislation, Mr. Chair, is in Part 2, Clause 40A, local board agreements. Now, local board agreements are between the governing body and the local board and will outline the activities and powers of the local board. This clause will limit the scope of local board agreements to activities within the purview of local boards. It also requires that the local board plan not be inconsistent with the strategies, plans and policies and objectives of the governing body. Now, our concern about that clause, Mr. Chair, is that the effect of this clause could be to allow the governing body to indirectly limit the actions of the local board. In other words, constrain local board's operation by outlining regional policy. The effect of this clause further underlines that local boards will be subservient to the governing body. Now, that's not putting the local back into local communities. Another clause where I want to outline a concern, Mr. Chair, is in Part 2, Clause 40C. The local board may propose bylaws. This clause amends the section that allows local boards to propose bylaws. Now, we're concerned about this because the Minister made a big deal about how local boards would be able to make bylaws as a way of illustrating how influential they were going to be under the Minister's new Auckland City. But however, this has never been the case. The local boards are only able to propose bylaws. And the sad truth of the Minister Hyde's super city model is that the local boards can only advocate to the super council for a bylaw and lobby them to pass it, just like any other lobby group in Auckland can. One more part, Mr. Chair, if I may. Part 2, Clause 45, new Section 77, disputes relating to local board agreements. Now, this section provides an avenue for local boards if they disagree with the Auckland Council regarding the allocation of decision-making responsibilities and proposed bylaws. Now, we're concerned about this because the Select Committee have removed the right of local boards to contest the local board agreement if they disagree with it. This underlines the dominant position of the Auckland Council and once again takes local decision-making out of the hands of local people. Part 3, another concern, Clause 87A, initial allocation of powers to the local board. This clause allows local boards to retain their initial allocation of powers from the ATA until the Auckland Council adopts its LTCCP for July 2012. This amendment allows the governing body to give local boards additional functions and powers, but it would prevent them from eroding the non-regulatory functions allocated by the ATA. So I hope... and that they're likely to have very little say over the operations to be corporatised by the CCOs. So I hope I've demonstrated, Mr. Chair, that we have looked at this legislation. I know the government members think that they're the only ones that understand it, and the people of Auckland are completely wrong, but there are many areas of concern, and I hope you see by my contribution we have taken this seriously. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Chairman.